Right, good morning. Today we're going to talk really the last part of what I want to talk about in terms of adsorption of chemical constituents in water. Been talking about it a couple lectures now. I wanted to take a look, closer look at this example that we left off on last time, look at how the book approached the problem, talk a little bit more about how adsorption occurs in a column scenario where we would have a packed bed of some sort of adsorbate. And we'll get into briefly kind of what it would look like to model the packed bed with mass balance. I know earlier we talked about how it can get very complicated. So with a few assumptions, we can take a look at that. So we'll talk about that a little bit, even though that sort of gets a little beyond the scope of what I care for us to build skills towards, but just so that we can kind of see what's out there, what can be done if you need to do it. So we're gonna pick back up here. We talked about this example where if we have two systems where we have adsorption happening, so we do some adsorption in this batch and then sequence it and do it in a second batch, and basically comparing that to what happens if we just had one larger batch, right? And the question was, well, is that the same or like what's different here? So comparing those two systems, we can see that if we have the, well, that's kind of what this example problem says, right? It's example 8.2, determine the activated carbon dose needed to treat the solution we described the previous example, if it's treated in two identical batch reactors in series. And so it says, assume that half of the activated carbon is added to each reactor. Basically, we're just splitting it in half, right? Instead of one big one, we have two half ones. And we have a separation where the activated carbon does not pass from one to the next. So then it says, well, answer this with an analytical approach and a graphical approach. So we talked about the graphical approach last time, talked about this slope term on this particular graph, where that slope is essentially the volume divided by the mass of adsorbate we're using. So the volume of the reactor. So if we did two and we see that that slope shrink, you know, that slope gets sharper, that means we're using less mass. So even if we used half the volume twice, the fact that we have new adsorbate the second time around means in both cases we're essentially making use of the isotherm when we're getting that steeper slope of more Q with lower concentration, right? If you remember looking at the adsorption isotherms, we have the Q on the y-axis and the C on the x-axis, and they tend to be pretty sharp, like high. I mean, I guess this graph is one of them, right? We tend to, with kind of low concentrations of our contaminant, we have a sharp increase here. So we get better usage of our isotherm by starting with fresh adsorbate as many times as we can, is what we're saying there. Okay, so the solution here for part A says the mass balances for the two reactors are linked because the treated water is going from one to the next. And because the problem states that W divided by V must be the same in both, so the mass used and the volume used, we can then apply this equation we had talked about. So we have an equation for W over V. 8.8-3 to obtain an expression for that. So it's an equation we used in the book, talked about last time. In each reactor, we can equate the expressions as follows, determining the concentration adsorption density of this phenol at equilibrium. We put all this in, and we say for reactor one, the W over V, and I apologize, perhaps this may ought to be W over V. So we'll see in a second. So in this case, we put in the numbers here for the first reactor, and we can solve for the condition after the first reactor. So if we were to take, again, thinking about it as C, this would be one initial going in, and then what we get out is C1, which goes into the second reactor. Right? So we can find the C1 for solving the first problem, first part of this reactor. This equation was given to us in the example we solved last time. That was 8-1. So that was just given as part of the problem. That's why we have that here. That's a Freundlich isotherm. And so we get some value there, and then we can use that C1 value and put it in for this C initial into 2, right? Because that would be the same thing as seeing that C2 initial. And solve for that. And that's what we see them substitute right here. Okay, so that gives us an analytical approach, and then when they take that, the Q initial is going to be 0 for both times, then we can get some solution here. And ultimately the problem says, or the solution says, we find that the required carbon for each reactor is 0.8 grams per liter. So total dose is 1.6 grams per liter. And that's about 73% of the dose required to treat it in a single batch that we solved last time in 8-1. Okay, and then part B was the graphical approach. Okay, does that make sense? All right. So, I think we may have mentioned this briefly, but if we were to put a lot of these in series, a lot of small batch reactors in series, what we find is we end up using our isotherm differently, right? Because one batch reactor, we could take a look at this type of plot, and we would be going from some high concentration to some low concentration that we had to meet. And if our isotherm is doing something like this, then we find, okay, well, right here is where we get it. And essentially, because we had to travel a far way in our concentration, we had to reduce something from, let's say, 10 milligrams per liter down to 1, that might be a treatment requirement that we have to meet. That means we have to use a lot of adsorbent. Because again, this slope we were able to equate to how much mass of adsorbate we were using. So as an alternative, this doing it multiple times, we increase that slope, we decrease the amount of mass required every time, then that's more efficient. But then we're doing these sequential batch systems, which, as you might consider, are not necessarily efficient to fill a batch, let it get to equilibrium, then drain it, keeping all the activated carbon, and transferring it every time, right? And batch systems don't give us a great way to do continuous flow systems particularly well, especially if we had to change the activated carbon each time or frequently. So that it's not necessarily practical, but we see how we can see how that would work in terms of improving our kinetics, improving our efficiency of the mass of our adsorbate used. So that brings us to, well, what happens when we have lots and lots of batches in series, or if we get them small enough and operate them in the right way, it's a little bit like a whole bunch of CSTRs in series. Well, that becomes a lot like a plug flow, right? That's how we defined a plug flow reactor in some sense. So we're approaching a plug flow reactor type system, which is actually how an adsorption column will typically work, right? So we have some column with a depth here, packed with media, and as your solution flows through, it meets new adsorbate, every centimeter, every inch it goes, you find new fresh adsorbate, and so whatever's in the water is experiencing a new layer or a new batch, a new plug of of your adsorbate as it moves through. And so you end up getting that plug flow-like process. Now, in a flow-through system, we have a couple of caveats here. First of all, it takes some time to reach equilibrium there. So it's not all immediately adsorbed. So what we end up getting is what we would call a mass transfer zone, or an active zone, where if we were to plot concentration, and this plot starts feeling a little weird because we're saying, okay, it's depth, but then this x-axis is not space. It's not just like we're measuring depth and width, right? And just seeing where the stuff is. This is depth and then how much concentration is still in the water, okay? So it's sort of a weird graph, but just bear with me. And we could do concentration or we could do adsorption density. Basically, we're taking the, as a function of depth, how much stuff has stuck or how much stuff has not yet stuck. And so with zero being, if we're going from the concentration coming in and we're moving it to zero by adsorption, right? So that's the concentration in the water. Whereas over here with the Q, our initial, our initial Q at equilibrium is pretty high. If we were at equilibrium with the water coming in, it's pretty high, but the Q where no water has gotten to yet is zero, right? There's no adsorption density where the water has not gone to yet. Okay, so if we look, we have some mass transfer zone or active zone where that process is happening, where that adsorption is actively occurring. Some of it has been removed and it's being removed as the water makes its way through, but it's taking some time to reach equilibrium, letting all the molecules find spots to adsorb, but it's going to drive it pretty close to zero if it's an effective process and if it's happening with some speed. So this leading edge, as time goes by, more and more water is treated. Eventually, we're going to pack it full. There's not going to be really any more adsorption sites available. And then at some point, this leading edge will make its way out the outlet, right? So here, you know, if this is the outlet, at some time, we're going to reach that spot where, now we've got escape of our contaminant, right? So we're pretty interested from a design perspective to know, well, how long is that going to take and how much is going to be coming out? You know, there's some important questions there. And this mass transfer zone, if it was really a very slow sticking process, then what could happen is we could have a system where the line looks a little bit more like this, right? And it's so slow that some of the stuff is leaking out from the beginning, basically, at a very early time. Some of the stuff pushes all the way out. I just drew it on this graph, be the same on either. If it's really, really fast, it might just about look square, right? Tiny little tail. And in some sense, that's ideal, that's what we want. So that we can say, hey, it's all absorbing, and then, okay, we've used all of our capacity, and now it's not absorbing anymore, so now we need to recharge. But if you're not careful, you can go from zero contamination to all the way contaminated coming out. So you normally have a secondary treatment system in line and monitoring in between to catch that as one example of a safety factor. Okay, so that's the definition of this mass transfer zone. It's going to be very important for us to understand that concept. How long does it take? How does that mass transfer zone look? And we can typically estimate kind of the number, or I guess the amount of water we can treat with some respect to this this transfer zone. So if we look, we have a couple equations here. So the number of bed volumes treated, so if I packed my 1 liter bottle with some sort of adsorbate, how many liters can I treat, right, before it's filled? And we could say that's going to be equal to the cumulative volume treated, obviously, divided by the total reactor volume. So you can just do it sort of brute force. How many liters did I treat? Divide that by the 1 liter. Pretty obvious. But it gets a little more interesting when you say, well, I packed this thing full of beads. Now we don't have a full liter there, right? So then we should actually look at the number of void volumes in here. So the kind of the void space, the actual the effective void volume within the reactor. And that's going to have some sort of like a porosity value times the volume of the reactor. So this is going to be the portion of the volume that is actually void and able to hold liquid, right? So that's kind of what that's referring to. Okay, so I talked about this a little bit already, that length of the mass transfer zone can be important. We don't want it to be too long. Too long would be a very slow adsorption process. We're not reaching equilibrium, or potentially not. We want to make sure that the mass transfer zone is shorter than the entire reactor, for sure. Because then, you know, and hopefully a fair amount shorter, so that we have the ability to use a lot of our reactor space. Because as soon as we start getting breakthrough and we're no longer meeting our treatment requirement, then that means that we actually have to add more adsorbate somewhere, whether it's in another reactor or what. And so the one way to look at it is, in this scenario, if the end was right here, then right here, right about here where this starts, everything to the left of this has been filled with our contaminant. That's fully used adsorption, you know, material. Everything in between is not quite full, right? Down here towards the bottom is quite full, or, you know, that means like a majority of the stuff has been used there. But up here, most of the adsorption capacity that could be if we reached equilibrium is not used. But we have to stop it, or, you know, stop it here, or add more adsorption material afterwards. So that's kind of what I was referring to when I say that mass transfer zone is helpful to have it shorter when possible, so that we make a fuller use. Because we see in this reactor on the right, the scenario on the right, again, if we just say that, hey, we just reached the end of it here, there's only this amount of space that is actually being used, right? So it's not a whole lot of usable space to really get the full effect of our adsorption, if it's that slow type of stuff. Okay, so don't mind the title here. At some point last time I was teaching this, some slides disappeared, so I drew it by hand and I forgot to update that. So I've been talking about the dual container system. This is, you know, probably what it would look like, where we'd have some input here into our reactor, and then sometimes we'd have some monitoring here so that we could take a valve and just check what's the status inside this reactor. So that's somewhat common, but perhaps the most common thing then is to take this and send it back through into in the next one and put a monitoring station here, where we collect samples and do routine monitoring between these two activated carbon systems. Would look a lot like this in reality. And then, so for example, for a leaky underground storage tank, some petroleum spill, something like that, the cleanup is usually is very often to be pumping the groundwater through a system like this, using the activated carbon until we get that mass transfer zone pushing out the other side, so until it's full. And as soon as that happens, we start detecting our compounds in the middle at that juncture. And then at that point, we know that we have to switch our operation. So rather than going through here and all the way through here, it's time to replace the carbon. Usually the carbon itself can be picked up and regenerated. A lot of times you can essentially burn off the petroleum stuff or otherwise separate it and process it. And you just start with fresh carbon again. And so in that scenario, what they would probably do is as soon as they start seeing some breakthrough, they would call up their supplier and order a carbon exchange for the next day or something like that. And then once it comes time to change this, they divert the flow to go through this one first instead of the left one first, right? So then you switch the order, and this is still has plenty of capacity because it just started receiving some contamination. And then the one on the left is now your backup, and you're gonna monitor in between until you see some contamination make it through. So that's like the common practice type of scenario, at least for that type of situation. And that's when you've got pretty good adsorption, pretty good speed at which the contaminant is going to stick to your adsorbent material. Okay, so like I said, the book does get into some mass balance here. At the start of talking about adsorption, I said that mass balances are pretty unwieldy. So what we're looking at here is in a fixed bed reactor, just taking a look at the mass balance and the adsorbate in the liquid phase. And it's still pretty unwieldy, right? So what I want to kind of take a look at is how the book is treating this with some example problems, and just to do a big picture overview of their process of it, show you that, hey, this can be done to an extent with certain assumptions. Not that I'm really keen on us developing that depth for the purposes of our class. Okay, so we're taking a look at a control volume that's bounded by the area of our cylinder here, cross-sectional area, if we have a cylindrical bed here, and some arbitrary dz, that differential in depth here. And so it's saying, okay, we've got some void fraction there, if we take a close look at that. So that's going to be our control volume, and we're looking at how the concentration in the liquid is changing as we're stepping through there. And so we have the accumulation term, rate of change of mass of dissolved adsorbate stored in that little segment that has the void fraction times the area times the depth. So that's going to give us essentially volume of water times dc dt, or partial. Then we have the what's coming in, so the net input into that section, plus the net input of dissolved by diffusion and dispersion. So we might assume an ideal case and ignore that. Then minus the net dissolved adsorbate lost due to the adsorption. So this is kind of our reaction that's taking it out of the liquid, right? That's the interaction with the interface there. Plus the net loss by chemical reaction. Sometimes we might have a chemical reaction going. Again, this would probably be one, in most cases we could assume is zero, because especially for adsorption systems, if there was a functional, effective chemical reaction that could take it out, why would we do adsorption, right? Why not just promote that chemical reaction and destroy it that way? So that's typically gonna be zero, at least for the simpler cases. So we'll say that's probably going to zero. We'll take that to zero with sort of ideal considerations. And so then we have some advection and some sticking, right? So with all of that, we can simplify it a fair bit. The book goes on to really defines two different types. One where we have a rapid equilibrium, and that gives us sort of this plug flow. That's what I wanted to take a look at today, just walk through some of the example problems, not even really solving them, just looking at how the book's going about them. A little bit of a low-key day in that sense today. Hopefully that's helpful in getting a sense for how the book's approaching the problems and kind of looking at the different types of systems. I think part of these problems, I mean, I think you could solve all of them. Some of this stuff feels a little unwieldy to me, and I don't want to get too far into the weeds there, because I think the basics of the adsorption process is what I'm after here. So we're going to take a look at how the book goes about using some of this, some of these equations. And this is basically them simplifying from here, our accumulation term, the advection term, and that rate of loss from dissolved, putting a few more parameters into it. And this is really for systems with rapid equilibrium and plug flow if the adsorbate is non-reactive. So basically all those assumptions I just kind of mentioned, right? And if dispersion is negligible. Okay, so with that, they give some description here. So it's kind of dCdt is equal to, this would probably be the velocity term for the travel. So that would be the, I think that's what the V is. I'm actually not sure. It might be a lowercase italicized V. I would think that a mu would look a little more like a nu. Could be. So like I said, I'm not digging too deeply into this, but what we see is it going through the solution. This would be the math in place to do it. We see the void fraction place in 1 minus the void fraction would be the fraction that is the adsorbent material itself, right?
The last slide on the mass balance.
Yeah.
What if like a biofilm started growing on your adsorbate? Would I don't know exactly what I was gonna ask, but I was wondering like would there be a way to attribute like loss of whatever pollutant in this kind of equation?
Okay, so That's a very interesting question. So if we had a biofilm growing on the material we're using in the column, I can see two things that could happen, right? One is, and I think this is what you're thinking, you could have the biofilm degrading the compounds, right? So some microbial action to treat it in some sense. I think that could be captured in this this term, and we would go back to our surface phase reaction type modeling where we have some surface area that has a reaction occurring within the volume and model it that way. I can see another aspect of it where it would also sort of potentially mitigate a lot of the loss due to adsorption if the biofilm isn't really letting the compound through to get to the pores, or if the pores are kind of blocked by bacteria hanging out. So I could see it sort of transferring from here to that regime potentially. Yeah, and that probably is a significant issue that adsorption processes have to contend with. So I would not be surprised if they have to chlorinate sometimes or something like that, because it really could, you know, biofilms really could foul the system. I mean, you know, sometimes maybe you're dealing with something so toxic that it there's not that chance of it growing, but definitely in some parts of it, especially if you are effectively removing that toxic stuff and then later the biofilm's growing later in the system and that, all that. So yeah, that's a good question. All right, so really I'm just gonna flip to the book now, which I meant to have ready. And what I'll do is I'll give you, you know, a minute or two to think about the problem, each problem. There's several of them. And then we'll kind of step through the book, talk about any questions, kind of try to make sense of it. That's strange. Okay, so example 8.4, we have a treatment objective described before. And let me see, is this 8-3 first? It was. Or did we already talk about that? Okay, yeah, we're just not. I don't know what that sound is. Strange. All right. Anyhow. Okay, 8-4. Treatment objective in this 8-1 problem, which we talked about last time. This was removing phenol. We had to remove it, I think, from 10 to 0.1 milligrams per liter, something like that. Is to be accomplished by packing activated carbon in a column through which the water containing 1 millimole per liter phenol will be passed. The depth of the packed layer is 2 meters. The apparent density of the adsorbent particles, this rho apparent, is 1.4 grams per centimeter cubed. The void fraction is 0.4. Superficial velocity of the feed is 9 meters per hour. And then assume that the solution is an adsorbent equilibrate with one another almost instantly, so we have a very small mass transfer zone, and that the hydraulics are approximately a plug flow. And that approximately a plug flow, that's pretty important because if you had some sort of fissure within your granular media, if you put too much pressure, sometimes you'll be able to, the granules will move aside and let water just kind of channel straight through. So you have some generic pressure limit and stuff. And if something like that happens, then you don't really have plug flow and kind of reactor sort of sucks. Okay, so anyway, with all those assumptions, part A is saying, how long can the treatment process operate before the effluent concentration exceeds the target of 0.05 millimoles per liter? How long could it operate before 50% or 95% breakthrough occurred? Okay, so just give that a moment to kind of think about what that's asking, and that's not what I meant to do. I'm gonna flip back just up a little bit as you think about those pieces, to see what kind of equation, you know, we were discussing. upstairs in a moment. So yeah, just give that a moment. Think about it. All right, so a couple of things that come to my mind is, one, we need some time function, right? And that's, we're gonna probably be relating that to this, the speed of travel of the water through the system. And we're gonna have to relate that to the amount of stuff going through the system then. We have some concentration, we have some reactor volume that we were given or maybe could solve for. And then we're going to have some pace at which the, or some relationship to how much adsorption is happening, right? And that's going to be from that Freundlich isotherm that we were given. So that's got to go into that adsorption term from our mass balance, right? So we have something about the advection that's going to capture the, that's going to give us some feature of the time, I think. The adsorption term is probably going to incorporate, well, how much adsorbent material is there? So, like, how much of the adsorbate will be removed? That's going to be making use of our, the density of our stuff and the void fraction in our stuff, right? So that's kind of the first few thoughts for me. So solution, then, oh, and part B before we go there. Part B says, what is the average effluent concentration up to a time of 50% breakthrough identified in part A? Okay, so we'll take a look back at that. Okay, the solution for part A, which was asking a few questions, said how long can the treatment operation go before the effluent concentration exceeds the target? How long could it operate before 50% or 95% breakthrough occurred? So basically, how long until that mass transfer zone is making its way out, right? Okay, so the solution says the system needs to meet these requirements for equation, excuse me, it does meet the requirements for this equation here to apply along with initial boundary conditions specified in these two equations. So it's, you know, talking about what the book was just talking about, of course. Furthermore, the values for the, I think it's the velocity and the void volume here are given. So the only additional term we're going to need to specify before we can solve is the product of this density times dq del q del c in the aqueous phase. And it says, to minimize clutter, units are not shown in these. In all cases, the applicable units are such and such. Okay, so the value for this density term can be computed as 1 minus the void volume times the density. So that's kind of going to give us a density of, I guess, the density of the absorbent material. And they calculate that. The adsorption isotherm, this was given in the very initial problem 8-1. So this is kind of nothing new here. Q is equal to that. And so we can get the slope of that portion. So if we take a look at what we need up here, one of the pieces in all of this equation is del Q del C. That's the slope of our isotherm. That's going back to those plots we were looking at that we said, well, how steep is our difference in concentration for difference in Q? So we're seeing that here relevant, and we also see that we can calculate that with our adsorption isotherm. Okay, so the known or derived values can be substituted, dC dt, and then we basically have values for almost all of that. So we're left with dC dt equals negative this stuff times dC dz, where the value of 1,000 in the denominator is a unit conversion. Okay, then we can integrate it with the initial conditions, no phenol at time zero. Integration carried out numerically. So they're doing a numerical integration, not an analytical one. Again, one of the reasons I'm not trying to do it ourselves right now, just seeing how they're doing it. To yield results shown in the next figure, which indicates the breakthrough curve is virtually a step function. So we'll take a look at that in a second. And then essentially they're using that numerical integration, which is, when they say that, that means they used Excel and calculated a bunch of case values or MATLAB or whatever, and calculated a bunch of case numbers for what that would turn out to be. And so with that, they were given all the breakthrough came out within a 7-minute span between 180 and 181 hours. So we could kind of expect that in a sense, because it said the equilibrium happened almost instantly. That's going to mean that mass transfer zone should be pretty small. If we had very, very little actual adsorbent in the system, that might increase the distance of the mass transfer zone. So if it was like a really, really narrow column, for example, that probably increased the way it looked. Okay, and this is the plot for their calculation of the effluent concentration over time. This goes joop, and that's apparently there is a slope there, but it's just very sharp. Okay, so part B for this problem said, what is the average effluent concentration up to time of 50% breakthrough identified? So really, this is just taking a look at that really sharp slope there. So the effluent during almost the entire run is phenol-free, basically. That's kind of their answer. Okay, the next example in line goes through a little bit more discussion here, some to do with the bed volume stuff. So the next example says, compute the number of empty bed volumes of water treated corresponding to 5% fractional breakthrough in this sample. And part B says, compare the activated carbon requirement per liter of water if the fixed bed system with the batch system in the previous problem, or in the example 8.1. So we did 8.1 in a batch system. We calculated it was 2-point-something grams per liter. And so given this problem is saying, okay, well, how much can we treat with one full bed of activated carbon. So that's going to be some volume of activated carbon, or some mass. And how many bed volumes can we treat until we reach that 5% threshold, which then we are no longer treating to our desired specifications. Then it's going to have us compare, right? That's the task for this problem. Now, this problem, I think, would be no problem for you to do. The previous problem, I felt like I didn't bother getting to the detail level required, but this one, I think it would not be so difficult given answers provided for 8.4. So the solution here says the empty bed detention time in the reactor can be computed using these equations. And okay, I guess maybe this one is a new equation here, but I think this is probably pretty straightforward. So empty bed contact time, it's gonna be the volume of the reactor divided by Q, which is basically the residence time, right? So that's a little bit self-explanatory there. Okay, so we can take a look there and say that's the volume divided by Q, and we can consider taking the cross-sectional area, dividing both the volume and the Q by that, and that gives us a condition where we have kind of the height versus the speed. So we're sort of putting it in flux type terms. Because we can divide volume and the flow rate by area, and that's just kind of converting the bottom to flux and the top to just a distance, right? So we can see how that could also be solved by just taking the how long it takes for water to flow some distance, right? It's just a fancy way of saying that. Use the velocity. So that's 0.22 hours. The time for treatment can then be converted into an expression for the number of bed volumes treated using this equation here. So the number of bed volumes is going to be the number treated divided by the volume of the bed, right? The volume treated. So that's also pretty obvious. And so the 5% breakthrough we calculated in 8.4 happened at 180.7 hours, right? So given that information, we knew that from the previous problem, then we can say, okay, well, if it takes 0.22 hours to go through the bed once, and we're going through the bed 180 times, 180 hours, we can calculate that that's about 813 bed volumes of water, right? So we've treated that many bed volumes. I'm sure we have the info to calculate the volume, the total volume that is, if we need it. And we can also calculate the mass of activated carbon within that bed, right? Because ultimately what we're gonna get to is the dosage of activated carbon per liter of water treated. And so we went from the batch scenario to this plug flow scenario where the batch is definitely not making ideal use of the adsorption, or adsorption capacity of the materials, whereas on this fixed bed really is. So part B then says the fact that the run lasts 813 bed volumes before the concentration exceeds the the requirement means that 813 liters of water are treated per liter of the fixed bed. So for every 1 liter within the fixed bed, we treat 813 liters of water. So that's another simplification method that I didn't even think about, right? But that should hold true. So the bulk packed density of the bed was computed before as 840 grams per liter. And so that means it takes 840 grams to treat 813 liters, right? And so that gives us 1.03 grams of activated carbon per liter of influent. Okay, so that's quite a lot better. I think the last one was, yeah, it was 2.2. So less than half the activated carbon when doing it in that manner. All right, does that make sense? Feeling right about that? Okay. Example 8.6. So the last one here, and this is pretty short. Estimate the time and number of bed volumes treated at breakthrough for the system described 8.5, assuming that the breakthrough curve can be approximated as a square wave. So instead of doing like the mass transfer zone with that little bit of a edge there that lasted like all of 7 minutes, it's saying what happens if it's a square wave and it all just comes out. There's no mass transfer zone, it's just all or nothing, right? It all just comes out. So if we approximate it as a square wave, we can apply this equation that they introduced here, which, you know, perhaps is one of the more useful ones if we want to simplify things, I suppose. We've got some known information, so we can solve for this number of bed volumes here. We can put in the Freundlich isotherm there to get our Q at equilibrium with the influent. That's the Q star here. And with all of this, the square wave calculates 181 hours. Right. So it's basically, okay, here's the way to do it that's avoiding your numerical integration step. if you've got a short mass transfer zone. Right. So at the end of the day, that is probably a very worthwhile simplification. So that seems to be at the end of the day the nice simplified practical equation that can be used in the in a setting where we're not trying to do numerical integration. Okay, so that's pretty handy. The book goes on, describes this table of key equations here for that and the assumptions. The next topic that we're not gonna cover, but the next topic in the book is systems with a slow approach to equilibrium, and it gets on into kind of the pore dynamics and the flux of your contaminant into the pores themselves. Also has some key equations listed. So if that's interesting to you, there's a lot of good material here. But that's going to be about it for adsorption of chemicals. Next time we'll talk about some of the adsorption processes for colloidal particles, so physical particle removal. I have some materials prepared for that. I will say that that morning is going to be, I might either be hyped up on coffee or very tired because I'm taking my wife to the airport at like four in the morning or something. So that'll be an interesting one. But okay, so that's all for this section. Any questions? All right. Okay, so said it a bunch already, but next week I'll be gone. I'm gonna get you set up with kind of a homework solutions. I'll record that. Might get a chance to record that before I leave, or I'll just do that while abroad. If I can, I'll set up a time to do so where it would be during a normal class time and you could ask questions. I think I can probably do that. So I'll try to do that for you, and you could log into our the Twitch page and ask questions live if you want. Also, we'll welcome emails, of course, and make a point to get back to you about questions there. Okay, so we'll see you on Thursday, and we'll at that point we'll cover some of the particle removal stuff.